Ricordate 17-17, sabato 17 alle ore 17, diciamo farò un'introduzione di un'oretta alla teoria dei giochi un po' più dettagliata nel Palazzo della Provincia, all'ultimo piano. Palazzo della Provincia, voi immaginate, c'è prima il Donizetti, poi c'è la Biblioteca Caversazzi e poi c'è il Palazzo della Provincia, lì all'ultimo piano, sabato 17 alle ore 17. 3, 2, 1... E finalmente riprendiamo questo lucido, perché è l'ultimo, e con questo lucido cerco di spiegarvi in poche parole come si innesta il discorso attuale del professor Nash sulla teoria dei giochi. Inizialmente i primi lavori di professor Nash furono legati ai giochi in forma normale, e lì nacquero gli equilibri di Nash, e lì nacquero, diciamo, la soluzione di contrattazione e così via. Ecco che già von Neumann e Morgenstern, nel momento in cui hanno introdotto il loro libro, la loro teoria, erano riusciti a collegare i giochi in forma normale con i giochi in forma estensiva, cioè avevano trovato un modo di trasformare un gioco dalla forma estensiva alla forma normale. E allora tutta la letteratura che si è occupata di queste cose è andata avanti di pari passo in molte cose, è riuscita ad andare avanti studiando insieme le due cose, da lì sono nati gli equilibri di Nash, diciamo le soluzioni Pareto ottimali e cose strane che peraltro sono digeribilissime, perché veramente basta impararle con calma e non c'è problema impararle, e sono andate avanti insieme. Invece i giochi in forma caratteristica erano strutturati in una forma completamente diversa. Qui era un discorso di ripartizione della torta, e si trattava di vedere come si sarebbero formate le varie coalizioni, e ciascuna coalizione cosa poteva chiedere, cosa poteva chiedere quell'altra, e così via. Era un modo di rappresentare i giochi un po' astratto, che non riguardava più le strategie dei singoli giocatori. Ecco, quello che è maturato in questi recentemente è stato un nuovo modo di approcciare questi giochi in forma caratteristica e di collegarli ai giochi in forma normale. Ecco, quello che farà in sostanza il professor Nash è partire da un gioco in forma caratteristica, e quindi già un gioco cooperativo in generale, che sarà magari un gioco a due o a tre persone, e in pratica studiarlo come se fosse un gioco in forma normale, cioè dal punto di vista dei singoli giocatori, dicendo: ma questo qui cosa fa? Gli conviene collaborare o non gli conviene collaborare? Sono delle strategie che decidono di fare i singoli giocatori. Quindi questo è un ribaltamento rispetto a tutta la teoria classica dei giochi in forma caratteristica. 1, 2, 3, voilà, questo sono io, e lasciamo la parola. Ladies and gentlemen, now... Okay, grazie. Now I became serious. Now I am the great honor and pleasure to introduce Professor John Nash from Princeton University.
Microphone for walking. Oh, I don't. Yes. Well, I don't have a walking microphone. I wonder. Well, I don't necessarily need it. You hear me well? Let me remark a little more about the book of von Neumann and Morgenstern, which went back to 1944. This book had a tremendous influence by really introducing the concept of cooperative games without calling them that by that name. And then I came out later on, and I had reason to talk of non-cooperative games, and then the dual area was created of cooperative games. It's just a matter of description. And but the idea of seeking a solution for these games, you might have five players, they have complex interactions, they can then gain or lose. So what is there to say about it? Well, von Neumann and Morgenstern did have a concept of a solution, but it was sort of a mathematical set theoretic concept. And some other concepts have been derived from that concept later on. One of the popular concepts is the core of a game. That's a very, very good, simple concept. Later on, after some years, it was found that the mathematical structure of von Neumann and Morgenstern solutions do not necessarily exist. It could find a game with 10 players, which could be shown to have none of these sets that formed a von Neumann-Morgenstern solution. And of course, also the form of the sets was very complicated, in many cases more so than for three players. And so it began to suggest that it might not be a practical concept. But I first considered games where the players would not seek to cooperate, would play independently, and I considered bargaining games where there could be two parties. In the one case, the non-cooperative game turned out to reflect back to the economics of Cournot and the Cournot solution, which is a century earlier. And the other case, the bargaining solution turned out to be, in special cases, the same as the solution of the economist Zeuthen, Z-E-U-T-H-E-N, who was Danish but lived in London. Now, from that time, there was another idea that developed, was that the idea of the solution of the games which are called cooperative games, which were basically games of like three or more persons, it could be two, but where they were not restricted to operate entirely independently and they did not have necessarily independent interests. They could somehow combine, maybe make agreements like states making a treaty, make a free trade area, then that became an area to study from my point of view. But I also suggested that perhaps this theory could be reduced to the theory of non-cooperative games. This is like reducing the theory of human social behavior to psychology, where one would, the psychology of human individuals, where one would consider each human as acting individually according to certain psychological behavior axioms and try to derive social behavior, from that. This might not be practical, or it might be. But I was not able to do anything for this for a long time. But when I received the Nobel Prize recognition in 1994, I thought more about economics and game theory. And there came a time, it's more than 10 years ago, in 1996, that I got a basic idea that could be studied in this direction, reducing a cooperative analysis problem to non-cooperative terms. Now, I can read off this. This is the history. The agency's method for modeling coalitions and cooperation in games. The idea leading to this study originated some time ago, in 1996, in fact, when I talked at a gathering of high school students at a summer science camp. I spoke about the theme of the evolution of cooperation in nature, and about how that topic was amenable to studies involving game theory, which more frequently has been used in research in economics. After that event, I was stimulated to think of the possibilities of modeling cooperation in games through actions of acceptance, in which one player would simply accept the agency of another player or of an existing coalition of players. The action of acceptance would have the form of being entirely cooperative, as if altruistic, and not at all competitive. But there was also the idea that the game would be studied under circumstances of repetition, and that every player would have the possibility of reacting in a non-cooperative fashion to any undesirable pattern of behavior of any other player. Thus, the game studied would be analogous to the repeated games of Prisoner's Dilemma variety that have been studied in theoretical biology. These studies of PD, or Prisoner's Dilemma games, have revealed the paradoxical possibility of the natural evolution of cooperative behavior when the interacting organisms or species are presumed only to be endowed with self-interested motivations, thus motivations of a non-cooperative type. Now, I have some remarks here about games in theory and experimental game studies. And I have been in contact also. Some of this got connected with experimental studies. And I can possibly go into that and present some PowerPoint version of that. Now, here's some general comments, but I maybe could skip through this. Now, there comes the question. See, there's actually a study here which is for three-person games in examples with varying parameters. And this is sort of a working study of the new idea, to see what sort of results would be derived from that. But in order to start to study it, one had to develop an idea, as a formulation, a model of this process of non-cooperative behavior, which could lead to cooperative behavior. Now, so how are the players going to get to cooperation while simply behaving in a non-cooperative way? Well, in the repeated game, this can happen. In what they study, there's a repeated prisoner's dilemma game where there's some payoff for cooperation, and at any point, a player could do more by breaking the cooperation, but then the whole situation might break down. In the prisoner's dilemma, if both players defect from the ideal of cooperation, well, they both go to prison, and they do not gain. If they both behave in the most cooperative manner, they're considered to be two parties that are in the hands of the police, and the police are trying to get one of them to confess or to expose the other one, to give them the evidence to convict the other. They're like confederates in crime. They maybe are like mafiosi. Now, if they behave in the right way in prison, if they behave like ideal mafiosi, then neither one will give evidence on the other, and they can get off with a much lighter penalty. They can be simply released. But if either one of them exposes the other, gives the evidence, then there'll be a penalty, a heavy penalty for the other one, maybe a death penalty.